Hello everybody. So the topic for today that we're going to discuss is furcation. So as we all know, chronic periodontal disease is a chronic inflammatory disease of the connective tissue apparatus. And this is induced by periodontal pathogens that reside in the gingival sulcus. Now the direction of progression of this disease is apical in nature. Now involvement of the furcation is one of the most serious anatomical sequelae of periodontitis. Now what exactly is furcation? Furcation comes with the word furca. It's a Latin word which means fork. Now this is basically the area that is located between the roots of a multi-rooted tooth. Now furcation is one thing that normally goes undiagnosed in various treatment procedures and various considering any treatment for any patient. So this, because it poses a lot of morphological changes, always complicates the treatment, and it's not an area which can be routinely debrided with normal periodontal instrumentation. So when we get into furcation, we need to actually be well aware of various terminologies we use when we discuss this particular subject topic. So we'll be discussing various terminologies when we discuss the topic furcation. So the first topic that we'll be discussing is, first terminology would be root complex. Root complex is the area that is below apical to the CEJ. Now this area is normally covered with cementum. This entire area forms the root complex. So the second terminology that we would be discussing is a root trunk. Now root trunk, this displays the undivided portion of the root. That is below, from the CEJ up to the apical, up to the furcation entrance. The third is the root cone. Root cone represents the divided portion of the root, that is from the furcal entrance up to the apical most portion of the tooth. So the next terminology that we'll be learning is fornix. Fornix is the roof of the furcation. Whereas the entrance, it's a transitional area that's present between the undivided and the divided portion of the root. This is the entrance. So we look into one of the questions that was asked regarding furcation. So 1 millimeter of furcation entrance diameter is seen in how many percentage, what percentage of the population? So the options are 35%, 81%, 100%, 50%. Now, deriving to this answer is nothing but you need to know the answer, because the various studies that has been conducted has concluded that almost 81% of furcations have 1 millimeter of orifice as an entrance, and 58% of furcations have 0.75 mm of orifice as the entrance. So the various other terminologies we would be learning is degree of separation. This is nothing but the angle that's formed between the two root cones. Now root cones, as I had already mentioned, is the divided portion of the root, that is from the furcal area up to the tip of the apex of the root. The degree of the divergence is the length of separation between the two root cones. Coefficient of separation is nothing but it's a ratio between the root cone and the entire length of the root complex. Root complex is from CEJ up to the base of the root. So since we're done with all the terminologies, we need to know what exactly causes furcation to exactly understand how this particular serious anatomical sequelae actually takes place. So there are various etiologies, but the prime etiological factor is bacterial plaque. So bacterial plaque and its long-term presence always affects the consequence of furcation involvement. So that is the first etiological factor. The second etiological factor that we should know is the endoperio lesion. What exactly happens is a pulpal pathology can start off and via its accessory canals can in fact infect the furcation involvement. So an endoperio lesion should always be considered one of the etiology for furcation involvement. So ideally, in such kind of a case, the tooth vitality, when we do, the tooth is negative, and then the endo treatment is completed, and mostly the treatment, I mean, the treatment is a success and then the patient has no concern. But in case there is a failure of treatment and there is no success that we see even after 2 months of endo treatment, then of course we have to intervene, we have to do a periodontal therapy there. So the third etiology of furcation involvement is trauma from occlusion. Now this is because of increased forces in bruxers, people who are having a lot of stress. So increased forces on the occlusal surface can affect the interradicular bone tissue and lead to furcal involvement. Now in these kind of cases, usually a minor occlusal adjustment kind of sorts the entire problem. And then if it doesn't, then we need to intervene and do a periodontal therapy. So the next topic that we would be discussing is what are the various factors affecting furcation involvement. So this is very important because this forms the prime focus. I mean, this can lead to worsening of the condition, and if this is sorted well, then I think the treatment is always a success. So the first thing that we would be discussing is root trunk length. Now root trunk, as I had already explained, is the undivided portion of the root. This area is the root trunk. Now root trunk length affects furcation how? If a tooth has a very short root trunk, okay, so there is very minimal amount of bone loss that needs to occur for the involvement of furcation. Whereas if a tooth has a very long root trunk, there needs to be a significant amount of bone loss that would lead to the furcation involvement. So the prognosis there decreases. Also in root trunk length, fused roots, very close approximated roots always affects the treatment of the furcation. So the second thing that we need to next consider is the root length. Now root length along with root trunk has to be considered here. Always remember, a short root trunk with a long root always has a better prognosis. How? A short root and there's a long root. There's a short root trunk and there's a long root will require very minimal amount of bone destruction for the furcation involvement. So the prognosis is always better because there is a higher amount of attachment already that's existing in spite of the bone loss. But in case of a long root trunk and a short root length, this significantly affects the prognosis because the root trunk is very long and there's a very short root. So there's a significant amount of bone loss that actually occurs for the exposure of the furcation. So there's very little attachment that's present. So the prognosis significantly reduces. So this has to be considered. So the third factor that I'll be considering is the root form. Now the maxillary and mandibular mesial root and the mesial root of the premolar, the first premolar, now they have concavities. Check this, it's almost tilted in the distal third and there's a concavity here and there is heavy fluting present. All of this poses a problem in maintenance because they are significant areas where there is more of plaque accumulation, so debridement is very difficult. So the mesial root of maxillary and mandibular molar has this small, in the apical third, it kind of tilts distally, and because of the heavy fluting that's present is a challenge in considering and treating the furcation. So the next factor that we would be discussing is interradicular dimension. Interradicular dimension is the separation that's present between the two root cones. Now, in case of a fused root, obviously the treatment is very difficult because there is no access, there is no visibility. So, accessibility is poor, so the treatment is always a question mark. In case of the interradicular dimension, so it's pretty wide, it's more accessible, then the treatment is always much better and the prognosis is good. So, that's the fourth factor that we consider. The fifth factor we consider is the anatomy of the furcation. Now, when we consider anatomy of Purkinje, what are the different things we need to keep in mind? The first thing, there are bifurcational ridges that are present. This is again a problem for maintenance of plaque. Second, there can be grooves. There can be heavy fluting of the root surface. These developmental grooves, all of this affects the Purkinje treatment. The next important factor that we need to consider, the sixth factor, is enamel projection, cemental enamel projection. Now, Master and Hawkins, in the year 1964, they classified the cervical enamel projections that's present here into three groups. So, grade 1 is when the enamel projection extends apically towards the Purkinje. Grade 2 is when the enamel projection approaches the Purkinje. And grade 3 is when it enters the Purkinje. Now, cervical enamel projection is very important because it's routinely seen almost 8.6 to 28.6% of all molars have this, and the most commonly affected are maxillary and mandibular second molars. So these were all tooth related factors that affected Purkinje. We also need to consider the heart tissue factors and the soft tissue factors. In the heart tissue factors, what we have to consider is the type of bone lesion that is present. In case of a horizontal defect, there is a very thin plate of buccal and lingual bone that is covering the Purkinje. And in case of presence of a bony ledge, this causes a problem in plaque maintenance because this leads to a vertical bone loss. So, need to consider the type of lesion that's present. In case of a soft tissue factor, we need to consider the amount of attached gingiva that's present. And also, we would want a moderate to deep vestibule. This is basically to plan a surgical treatment. So these are the important factors. So we have tooth related factors, we have heart tissue factors, and we have soft tissue factors affecting the Purkinje. Let's come to classification of Purkinje. So Glickman in the year 1953 classified Purkinje into grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4. Now there are various classification based on horizontal component, vertical component, combined horizontal and vertical component. But the two most important classification that you need to remember is Glickman's classification and Tarnow and Fletcher. So now let's discuss Glickman classification. So grade 1 is the incipient lesion. Now, there are a few points you need to remember whenever grade 1 Purkinje comes to your mind. There are just 2 to 3 points that you need to remember in your sort. So, the first thing you need to remember is it's an incipient lesion. The second thing you need to remember is it's a supra bony pocket. And the third most important thing that you need to remember, which has been frequently asked in various MCQs, is there is no radiographic evidence in this grade 1. So there's very minimal bone loss. So what are the three things? Let's just revise that. Incipient lesion with a supra bony pocket. And the third is there is no radiographic evidence. So coming to grade 2, the moment anybody says grade 2 Purkinje, the first thing that should come to your mind is cul-de-sac. Now, cul-de-sac means that a route which has no way. It's a dead end. So, there is a definite horizontal component that's present here, which leads to this particular term that we use, that's called cul-de-sac. When we consider grade 3, what are the different things we need to keep in mind? The first thing is, there's obviously a horizontal component that's attached, and there is bone loss that's present. So here the bone is no more attached to the dome of furcation. Okay. The second thing you need to remember is the periodontal tissue there covers this furcation involvement. So the clinician can barely pass a probe in case of grade 3 because there is a tissue that is covering the furcation defect. In case of grade 3, grade 4, it's a through and through lesion. So there is recession of this tissue that was earlier covering in grade 3. So it's almost through and through, and the clinician can easily pass a periodontal probe in grade 4 furcation lesions. So that's grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4, and that was the classification given by Glickman in the year 1953. Coming to the next important classification is Tarnow and Fletcher. Now in 1984, Tarnow and Fletcher classified furcation, but this was based on the vertical component. Glickman's classification was based on the horizontal involvement of furcation. So what was their classification? They divided furcation into three classes, subclasses. So there is subclass A, subclass B, and subclass C. So what did he say about subclass A? He said that there is a vertical destruction up to one third of total interradicular height. Now this, if we calculated numerically, this accounts to 1 to 3 millimeters. Subclass B, when he said that almost two third of the interradicular height was involved. And this constitutes 3 to 6 millimeter of bone loss. Whereas subclass C is more than 2/3 of the interradicular height, which is almost more than or equal to 7 millimeters of vertical bone loss. So the classifications are very important because they can be asked as one of your MCQ. So since there are so many classifications in furcation, just remember Glickman and Tarnow and Fletcher. These are the two most important classifications that you need to remember whenever you discuss furcation. So let's go to one of the questions and try and solve it, since we already know about the classification. So furcation involvement with no radiographic evidence. Grade 2, advanced grade 2, grade 1, early grade 3. I told you that's the first thing that you need to remember. There are a few points when you consider grade 1. First thing, incipient lesion. Second thing is the pocket is supra bony, and third is there's no radiographic evidence. So by just knowing no radiographic evidence, you can pick out the answer. That's the option C as grade 1. So the next question we look into, one of the following is not a feature of grade 3 furcation. Even before looking into the options, let's just kind of revise what were the features of grade 3 furcation. The first thing is the bone is not attached to the dome of the furcation. The second thing is the tissue is actually covering the furcation. Third is the clinician can barely pass a periodontal probe there. So now let's just go through various options. So the first option A is bone is not attached to the dome of the furcation, which is a feature of grade 3 furcation. We are trying to find out which is not a feature of grade 3 furcation. So the second option is opening of the furcation is not clinically visible, which again is a feature. The periodontal probe passes readily from one aspect of the tooth to another, which is a feature of grade 4 and not grade 3. The last option is display the defect as a radiolucent area in the focal area of the tooth, which is correct, of grade 3. So the answer, if I'm trying to exclude, as in which is not a feature of grade 3 furcation, is the option C, which is a feature of grade 4 furcation. Next, we need to consider how exactly we diagnose furcation. So there are various techniques when we diagnose this particular case. When a patient comes to walk into your clinic, you want to diagnose whether the patient is having a furcation or not. See, radiographically, grade 1 has, it does not even show up on the radiograph. And routinely, when the first patient comes into your clinic, you just don't take an x-ray immediately. First, you will clinically examine the patient. So what are the different techniques we can use when we are trying to diagnose this condition? The first way we diagnose this is by using Naber's probe. Now, Naber's probe is exclusively used for furcation involvement. Now, this probe has markings at level 3, 6, 9, 12, and it is color coded from 3 to 6 and 9 to 12. Now, that's the way the Naber's probe is inserted in the furcation, and you can get to know the amount of bone loss that is present, and you can measure based on the graduations. So the second technique that we use now, transgingival probing is nothing but you need to anesthetize the area and then probe. Now this comes to the advantage for the fact that you can know what is the type of lesion, bony lesion that is present, the extent of furcation involvement. You can also know what is the complication that it poses to the adjacent tooth. So transgingival probing comes handy when we diagnose the furcation. The last resort and another resort to diagnosis is the radiographs. Radiographs we can use intraoral periapical radiographs or a vertical bite wing to diagnose the furcation. So that comes to diagnosis. We use a Naber's probe, we do transgingival probing, and we take the help of radiographs. Next, the most important part of furcation, since we all know what causes furcation, the etiology, the factors affecting it, the various diagnostic techniques, the classification, most important part is management of furcation. What exactly we look into when we're trying to treat this particular defect? Now, the various factors that we need to keep in mind, there's patient-related factors and there are tooth-related factors. So when we consider the tooth-related factors, you need to look into the extent of furcation involvement. Now, how much of connective tissue is lost? What is the remaining amount of connective tissue support that you need to, you know, kind of treat? Then the type of bony lesion that's present. You also need to consider the extent of the lesion, whether it's affecting the adjacent tooth. You will need to consider the endo lesion also. And these are the various tooth-related factors you need to keep in mind when you plan a management. What are the patient-related factors that you see? You see what is the patient expecting, what are the functional and aesthetic demands, whether he is able to have a good compliance and whether the oral hygiene is good, whether he's practicing additional oral hygiene methods, and what exactly can be done for the betterment of that particular condition. I mean, what is the step that we take, whether we plan as a regenerative or a resective procedure or we plan an extraction, all of that considers and it has to actually form the base on the patient and tooth related factors. So there are objectives that we need to keep in mind before planning to how to manage a furcation. So the first objective that we actually look into whenever we see a furcation is we want to facilitate the periodontal maintenance. Obviously, if we are maintaining that particular area, there is no plaque accumulation. Obviously, there won't be any progression of the disease. So periodontal maintenance is very important, the accessibility, the visibility of whatever defect that's present. The second thing that we need to consider is you want to prevent further attachment loss. the third objective that we need to look in is you want to obliterate the Purkinje effect, the Purkinje effect. So the first thing that we consider an objective is you want to facilitate periodontal maintenance. The second thing is you want to prevent further attachment loss, and the third thing is you want to obliterate the Purkinje effect. These are the three objectives you need to keep in mind whenever you're managing Purkinje. So there are three broad strategies of Purkinje therapy that was given. So the first thing that was considered is you want to maintain the existing Purkinje. Now the Purkinje is the initial stages, you're just maintaining it. So how do you maintain it? First thing is scaling and root planing, that forms the basic start therapy of every possible periodontal therapy that we do. Second is obstruction of Purkinje. We can do anything that kind of obliterates, that kind of reduces the Purkinje depth. The second is increasing the access to Purkinje. Now sometimes what happens is there is no visibility and there's no accessibility to clean that particular Purkinje involvement. So what this causes is, this causes more problems in plaque control, there'll be more further accumulation, there'll be leading to more periodontal destruction. So when you're increasing the Purkinje access, that can be done via gingivectomy or a apically positioned flap, or you can do an odontoplasty or an osteoplasty or an ostectomy. I will explain each of the terms in the coming slides. So the third option that we need to see in Purkinje therapy is the elimination of Purkinje, completely eliminating the Purkinje. How can this be done? It's either done by root amputation or tooth resection or by bicuspidization. So we have various surgical and non-surgical therapies that we need to consider when we start off with Purkinje. So non-surgical therapy is usually enough in case of grade 1 or shallow grade 2 defects, and surgical therapies when we consider deep grade 2 or grade 3 and grade 4 lesions. Non-surgical therapy always forms the forefront for all the therapies, but for grade 1 and shallow grade 2, that can be an enough treatment. You don't have to do anything more. In case of any ridges, any kind of bony lesion, then you can do a little bit of osteoplasty or ostectomy. Now, next thing we need to see is what exactly we use during non-surgical therapy. Now, various specialized instruments that we use in case of Purkinje treatments. So, scaling root planing is done. Now, what kind of curettes do we use for Purkinje involvement? There is DeMarco Purkinje curette that can be used. There can be Quitin Purkinje curette and Odi and Ishikawa actually came up with an ultrasonic scalar tip exclusively designed for easy accessibility to the Purkinje. So these are the various curettes and scalars that we can use for proper access to the Purkinje. So let's go to each treatment aspect individually and see what all can be done for each kind of Purkinje defect. Odontoplasty, as I said, is mostly done for grade 1. Of course, it can be used in an adjunct for grade 2, grade 3 for the lesions, but odontoplasty is more sufficient for grade 1 kind of defects. What do we exactly do here? We reshape the tooth surface that is coronal to Purkinje. So by doing this, we are reducing its horizontal depth. As I told you, mainly advised for grade 1, and grade 2 shallow defects, of course, we can use odontoplasty. So coming to one of the questions, odontoplasty is indicated in grade 1 Purkinje, grade 2 Purkinje, grade 3 or grade 4 Purkinje. So most commonly it's used for grade 1 Purkinje, grade 2 for shallow defects, but whenever odontoplasty is asked as which is primarily indicated, then the answer is grade 1 Purkinje involvement. So coming to the next treatment procedure, it's osteoplasty or ostectomy. What are these terms? Osteoplasty is reshaping of bone surfaces that's not involving the tooth supporting bone. And ostectomy is you're reshaping along with removal of supporting bone. Now, there's improved plaque control through osteoplasty. How can exactly this be accomplished? The first thing is by creating a ramp into the furcation. Now, creating a ramp into the furcation helps the gingival tissues to tuck in. So, there is very less exposure of the furcation. So, there's less ingress of the bacterial products and then it reduces the amount of destruction. Third is, you alter the lip of the bony defect. Now, this reduces the horizontal defect. So, as it reduces the horizontal defect of the furcation, you have easy maintenance. There is no extra factor that is posing to more plaque accumulation over there. The third way that we can accomplish plaque control is by apical positioning of the flap. Now, this reduces the pocket depth. So, all of these contribute to better plaque control. How do we increase the access to furcation? There are two techniques. One is gingivectomy and the other is apically positioned flap. Now, they can be used to reduce and eliminate pockets over the furcal involvement, and this obviously increases access for plaque control. Furcation plasty. Now, furcationplasty is where you alter and obliterate the furcation. Now, exactly, you don't eliminate the entire furcation, but you alter it so that there is more better plaque control, there is less anatomic factors that is posing to more plaque accumulation. So, this can be used with a combination of odontoplasty, osteoplasty, osteectomy. All of this can be used in furcationplasty. Now, how exactly is this done? A full thickness flap is raised in the concerned tooth and all the tissues, all the granulation tissue is debrided in that area. And then you can do odontoplasty if there is any tooth related defect there. Osteoplasty and osteectomy is done to eliminate any bony problems, bony lesions over there. After that, thorough debridement and cleaning is done and then the tissue is apically displaced and sutured. Here the tissue is sutured as such that the tissue fills the furcation involvement. So there is no direct exposure of furcation. So there is less entry of bacterial products in this area, which leads to further attachment loss. So this is the way the furcation plasty is done. So the next procedure that we can do while managing furcation is tunneling procedure. Tunneling procedure is when we convert a grade 3 furcation into grade 4. So, what is grade 3 and what is grade 4? Let's just revise that. Grade 3 is when there is a definite horizontal component of furcation, but that furcation is covered with a soft tissue. Whereas in grade 4, soft tissue has receded and there is almost a through and through involvement of the bone, the furcation. So, when you're converting grade 3 to grade 4, this is basically done to facilitate periodontal maintenance because it's very easy for the patient to maintain that area. There is no plaque accumulation there, so there is no further attachment loss. So while we convert grade 3 to grade 4, we expose this particular area. We devoid it with, there is no tissue here, so we convert it into grade 4. So this area is open for periodontal maintenance. An interproximal brush can be advised to the patient to keep that area clean. So the next treatment that we look into is root separation and resection. So there is a sequence of treatment. Neville in 1991, he gave a three-step procedure. So there are three steps that you can consider whenever there is root resection that's considered. One is an endodontic phase, a restorative phase, and a surgical phase. In endodontic phase, the root canal treatment is done. So, there is no pulpal pathology and when we are performing root resection, there is no pulpal pain to the patient. So, all of that is avoided. Then comes the restorative phase. So, the basic restorative phase that we do is a crown buildup and you do a give a provisional restoration and then go to the surgical phase. In surgical phase, you can do bone recontouring, apical position flaps and all of that can be done. But we need to come back to restorative phase by giving the final crown. The final crown has a knife-edged margin. It has an apical extension for ferrule effect and you need to maintain the biologic width.
So, what are the guides to determine which root do I remove when I am actually planning a root resection? So, there are various things that you need to remember. The first thing is remove the root which will completely eliminate the furcation. So, you need to plan when you see you want to do a root resection. Resect the root that completely eliminates the entire problem. So, eliminates the furcation. The second thing that we need to consider for removal of root is remove the root that has maximum attachment loss. Anyway, it is not serving the purpose. It's not giving any form and function there. So, whichever has the maximum periodontal attachment loss, we can resect that root. Third thing is eliminate the root which will also eliminate any periodontal problems considering the adjacent root. For example, there is bone loss in one particular root and that is also causing further bone loss in the adjacent root. You can remove that root, so which solves the problems of the adjacent root. So the fourth factor that we consider in root resection is you can resect the root which has maximum anatomical problems like bifurcation, ridges, fluting, concavities, all of that. So which has anatomical factors can influence which root to remove. So the fifth thing is, which is least complicated, which is easy. So consider the complication factors and consider which tools to resect. So basically, root resection is you're resecting a root without removal of the overhanging crown there. So it is just the root resection, we retain the crown portion of that root. So how exactly is this done? So your full thickness flap is raised and it's all debrided, all the granulation tissue is removed. And it's raised up to the extent where the visibility is clear because we are actually resecting a root. And then there's a thin layer of bone that's present which is covering the buccal plate and the lingual plate. That a small window is created so that there is easy visibility of the particular root that you need to remove. So you need to create a window there. And then the root is resected. So whichever root is decided to be resected is resected in an oblique direction. So it's that is apical to the see contact point towards the furcation, the root is resected. Now, why do we use an oblique direction? Why not, you know, a horizontal direction? That is just to preserve the pulpal chamber there. Any root resection, the first thing that we need to see is the endodontic treatment. You have to do an endodontic treatment, only then a root resection is planned. So, after the root is resected, it's elevated, it's removed, the entire area is clean. You can take a diamond point to soften the edges of the root there that's removed. After that's resected, the tissues are sutured. So, this is the way a resection, root resection is done. So, let's look into one of the questions. Root amputation, that's nothing but root resection, is not indicated in. And there are options. Now, to understand not indicated in, you need to know what are the indications and what are the contraindications of root resection. Let's look into the indications of root resection. So, there are various periodontal indications. There are endodontic indications. And there are prosthetic indications. What are the periodontal indications? Where there is maximum attachment loss. Where there is grade 2 to grade 3 furcations. Grade 2 to grade 3 furcations. Where there is severe dehiscence. What are the endodontic factors that we consider is when there's inability to seal a particular canal. Canal problems, canal factors, then there can be root perforation. or fracture in case of root decay? What are the prosthetic considerations in case there is any violation of biologic width? So these are various indications that we consider for root resection. So when I come to contraindications, you can consider the systemic factor of a patient, the health of the patient. Now, in root resection, only the root is removed and the adjoining crown is retained. So, in that case, a good compliance and the patient hygiene factors are very important. So, the patient hygiene, in case if it's a bad oral hygiene, then definitely that's a contraindication for root resection. Then, fused roots. A root resection cannot be performed in case of fused roots. So now, since we know the indications and contraindications of root amputation, let's just go back to the question. So root amputation is not indicated in. Root perforation, yes, it is indicated. It is a endodontic indication. Severe dehiscence or recession of the root, again, it's a periodontal indication. Fused roots, yes, root amputation is contraindicated in fused roots. Root decay, yes, it is an endodontic indication. So, the contraindication is fused roots. So, the next question that we are trying to solve is the most commonly resected root in the maxillary molar. So, in a maxillary molar, the most common resected root based on various studies is a distobuccal root. So, you need to know this. So, a distobuccal root is the answer that is the most commonly resected root in a maxillary molar. Coming to the next treatment procedure, it is hemisection. Now, what exactly is hemisection? It's nothing but the vertical sectioning of the root. So, you can either remove the root along with the adjoining crown that is, you know, most severely affected. So, basically, you divide the tooth and whichever is more affected, you remove that particular part of the tooth and retain the one that's good, which can be used as an abutment and for any other purposes. So this decision of hemisection, it depends on the amount of bone loss, the root trunk and root length factors, the ability to eliminate the osseous defect by performing this procedure, and the various restorative and endodontic concerns. So first thing that we do for this hemisection is obviously a root canal has to be done before doing this procedure. So the direction of root sectioning will be vertical. And it is in buccolingual direction. So from the buccal groove to the lingual groove, the mandibular molar is hemisected. So the most commonly hemisected tooth is a mandibular molar. So this is how we section the tooth. And then this is the remaining portion of the tooth. So the remaining portion, this one, the hemisected can act like the abutment. So the next treatment procedure is bicuspidization or root separation. This is similar to hemisection, but here we are retaining both the components. So basically it is done to focal involvement is the area which the most problematic factor that takes place in focal involvement is development of caries. When that's done, it just worsens the prognosis. Everything is messed up there. So basically by doing bicuspidization, you are eliminating the whole problem. That is, you're completely separating a mandibular molar into two different components. So the entire focal involvement is gone. So and this particular zone, which is more prone to caries, this acts like a metal line where the crown exactly fits into that area. So there is no problem with regards to the percussion. So here, this is again the direction of tooth section is vertical here. So the tooth is divided and there are two separate crowns given in both the portions. So the most prone area for caries is converted into a metal line by giving two separate crowns in two different portions. We have discussed how we do various basic steps, basic procedures like odontoplasty, osteectomy, osteoplasty and various root resective procedures. These are all to obliterate, to remove the focal involvement. But what about regeneration? Regeneration is very important because there are various studies and there are various techniques how we can regenerate the lost bone. We can, maintain the anatomy of that particular area. We can regenerate the lost structures. Now, how exactly this is done? There are various techniques. Let's discuss it one by one. The first thing that has been widely used and is still being widely used is GTR. GTR is nothing but guided tissue regeneration. Now, guided tissue regeneration works on one principle, that is selective population of cells. So, what is selective population of cells? Now, there are various barrier membranes. It can be a resorbable barrier membrane, it can be a non-resorbable barrier membrane. What exactly is done is this barrier membrane is placed to exclude the alveolar bone and the periodontal ligament from the epithelium. So now this barrier membrane is excluding this area and it is letting the periodontal ligament cells to repopulate that area and regenerate the lost connective tissue attachment. By preventing epithelial migration, had there been no barrier membrane that's been placed, there will be epithelial migration there and there is no connective tissue regenerated over there. So, there is selective population of what cells? Periodontal ligament cells. So, here there is a barrier membrane placed here which secludes the alveolar bone and the periodontal ligament from the epithelial migration of cells. Let's look into one of the questions. A 50-year-old patient has undergone periodontal surgery in which a polytetrafluoroethylene membrane is used. This is a GTR membrane. What is the role of this membrane? Since we already know the principle of GTR and we know how we are excluding the alveolar bone and periodontal ligament cells for the repopulation of the connective tissue attachment there by preventing the epithelial migration, I think finding out the answer is very simple. Option A is repopulation of the areas by cells from the gingiva, which obviously we are preventing. Repopulation of the area by cells from the alveolar bone? No. Repopulation of the area by cells from the periodontal ligament? Yes, because the periodontal ligament cells have the capacity to regenerate the lost connective tissue attachment. Causes epithelial migration? No. The entire concept of doing GTR is to prevent the epithelial migration. So the answer is you want to repopulate the area by cells from the periodontal ligament. So what are the various regenerative procedures that can be done? First thing we discussed was GTR. Second thing is endogain. What is endogain? It is an enamel derived protein. So what is enamel derived protein? It's nothing but it's amylogenin that is secreted by Hertwig's epithelial root sheath, which facilitates acellular cementum formation. Now, endogain has properties where it repopulates the periodontal ligament cells to regenerate the lost periodontium. So, this is one of the regenerative procedures techniques that we can use. The second technique is we can use bone grafts, the various bone grafts that can be employed in regenerating the lost alveolar bone. There is PRP and PRF. PRP and PRF. Now, PRP is nothing but platelet-rich plasma. Now, the blood of the patient is centrifuged and PRP is derived from there. What exactly is PRP? It's a concentrated form of plasma which has a lot of platelets. Now, why is this important regeneration? Because these have growth factors. Most important being platelet-derived growth factor and transforming growth factor beta. Now, these growth factors help in regenerating the lost periodontium. PRF is used because this acts like a scaffold. It's basically a fibrin cloth. It acts like a scaffold over which various cells repopulate. Again, very highly concentrated with various growth factors which helps in regeneration. Now, PRP, PRF, bone graft, endogain, all of this can be used as a combination therapy. It's not like one regenerative procedure is only used. So you can use various tools depending on the case selection, depending on the type of defect, the type of bone lesion. You can use various combination therapies. The next treatment aspect that we are looking at is glass ionoma restoration. Now, this is an economical alternative done for almost a hopeless tooth. A patient doesn't want to undergo extraction and still wants to retain the tooth, and the percussion there is causing a lot of problems in plaque removal. There's a lot of plaque accumulation, so the maintenance is compromised. In such cases, we can restore that particular percussion. So what does this restoration do? It blocks and seals the percussion. It reduces the horizontal component, eliminates any ingress of bacterial products, any plaque in that area. Basically, it, you know, prevents any further attachment loss. So what are the different materials that we can use for this? We can use a glass ionoma cement. We can use an IRM, that is reinforced zinc oxide eugenol. We can use amalgam for that matter. So this is one of the restorative treatments that we use for percussion treatment. So what is one of the last resorts that we look into, which we always try to kind of avoid, because prevention is better than cure, right? So we always want to retain whatever is lost. We want to regenerate it. And we never want to think of this. That is extraction. But nonetheless, when we cannot employ any of the treatment procedures in these kind of cases where there's hopeless prognosis, the attachment loss is beyond repair, we have to consider extraction. Extraction as in a strategic extraction for tooth which we cannot repair and which is only going to cause further problems if we try to retain it. In such kind of cases, extraction is the only option. So there are various treatment techniques that I have discussed. It's not used solely alone, as I discussed. It can be used as a combination of various techniques. It all depends on the type of case, the type of lesion, the extent of lesion, all of that. Let's look into one of the questions. What is the purpose of using the following? Now, there's an image that's given which reads endogain gel. Now, we know what is an endogain. It's an enamel-derived protein. So, we know the entire uses of endogain. Let's just revise that before getting into this. So, endogain is an amelogenin. Now this is released by Hertwig's epithelial root sheath during acellular cementum formation. So used for periodontal regeneration purposes. Let's look into the options for regeneration procedures. Yes, that is the answer. It's not used as a periodontal dressing, not as an antimicrobial agent. So the answer is it's solely for regeneration procedures. The last part of this topic that's very important is prognosis. You want to predict the likelihood of the course of direction of that particular problem. Whether it's going to be good, whether it's going to be, you know, it's going to worsen or it's going to get better. So what are the different things that we consider while prognosis? So initial focal involvement, that's grade 1, can be successfully managed by non-surgical treatments. And in case there are any complications like vertical fractures or there is any endodontic failures, then we need to, you know, consider the other treatment options. So whenever we consider grade 1 furcation, it is always comes up with a fair prognosis. Grade 2, a grade 1 and shallow grade 2 comes with a poor prognosis, and grade 3 and 4 is questionable prognosis. There are three teeth, right, which have like, which are multi-rooted. They're the maxillary molars, mandibular molars, and your maxillary premolars, mostly. It's multi-rooted. So when we consider the prognosis, the mandibular molars has the better prognosis when compared to the maxillary and molars and the maxillary premolars. The second comes the maxillary molars, and the last, which has, when compared to these molars, which has the least prognosis, is a maxillary premolar. So that is the order that you need to remember whenever prognosis flashes your mind. The tooth with a better prognosis first is a mandibular molar, second is a maxillary molar, and third is a maxillary premolar. So prognosis is poor for furcation involvement of which tooth? I know the order: mandibular molar, maxillary molar, and maxillary premolar. So coming to the option, it's maxillary first premolar, maxillary second molar, mandibular first premolar, and maxillary second premolar. I can just pick out that the answer is maxillary first premolar. Questionable prognosis is how much amount of clinical attachment loss. Now, before given looking into the options, you need to know how much, what prognosis amounts to what amount of attachment loss. Let's look into four types of prognosis. One is fair, one is poor, then there is questionable, and there is hopeless. So, fair prognosis is when there is 25% amount of attachment loss that has taken place. Poor prognosis is when there is 50% of attachment loss that has taken place. Questionable is when there is more than or equal to 50%. And hopeless is when there is beyond repair and there is a lot of attachment which affects the form, the comfort and the function of the tooth entirely. Okay, it affects the form, the comfort and the function. So, knowing this, let's go back to the question. Questionable prognosis. So, questionable prognosis is when it involves 50% of the attachment loss. So, the answer is option A, that's 50% of the clinical attachment loss. Now, since we have already discussed furcation, what is the main important thing that you can keep in mind when you're discussing this particular diagnosis, this particular condition? See, furcation usually goes undiagnosed in any clinical scenario. That's one thing that we don't intentionally fail to, but yes, that does go undiagnosed. Early diagnosis of furcation involvement has a better prognosis. It has a long-term prognosis. We are just not looking at solving the issue, but we are also looking at a long-term prognosis for the patient welfare. So in that case, an early diagnosis of furcation solves majority of the problems. And if that is misdiagnosed or undiagnosed, it leads to further attachment loss, which we cannot actually repair. So, whenever we consider treatment of furcation, there are just few things we need to consider for the long-term success. A thorough diagnosis, we have to consider that. We have to employ all our diagnostic instruments for diagnosing this furcation, that is Nicol's probe. Then you have your transgenital probing, or you can use your radiographs. Diagnose the condition. After that, consider the patient selection is very important. So, what kind of patient will have a long-term prognosis. So, compliance, oral hygiene methods, reinforcing the importance of cleaning, the importance of scaling and routine, the importance of coming every 3 months to 6 months, visiting a dentist to get your entire oral mouth checked. That is very important. So, the patient compliance is very important. The patient oral hygiene is very important. So, when this is followed in this order, I think this focation involvement doesn't progress to a much worse condition when we cannot do anything, because this is something, once a tooth is lost, it's very difficult to replace it, and the patient gets a lot of issues with adjusting to the new framework. It's better, prevention is always better than cure. So early diagnosis, selecting the correct patient and reinforcing them to perform the oral hygiene habits in a sequential way to reinforce their patient appointments with their dentist on a regular basis, on a recall basis, is very important to deal with this issue. So, I think that's it.